somebody cannot hear me. Okay, you just complain and then I will start. So, when I came as a kind of first year undergraduate to Stanford University, I was kind of attending the course in psychology by Rockin, and the name John Milnor was one of the first medical name I really learned from Juan Carrera, one of my cultural shocks when I came to Virginia to go to the United States was to discover that, first of all, John Milnor is not drawn by Jack, and the second is he's so young. And actually, kind of someone's age is just, of course, the perception of someone's age depends on your age. It's actually probably something like ratio. So I'm really happy to see that every year Jack becomes younger and younger. Well, so I'm going to talk, and I hope it will be very elementary talk, and of course, clarity, and will be a little bit of dynamic, but not much. And also, I will Dennis, in his first lecture, promised that I will talk about a lot of stuff. I will mention a little bit of this, but all what he promised. So non-trivial symplectic geometry begins with a plane or with a disk and with area-preserving transformation of the disk. And non-trivial contact geometry begins even early. It begins with circle and with a diffeomorphism of circle. And, well, everyone knows that diffeomorphism of circle is a kind of creating subject. We have, for instance, this invariant rotation number for the diffeomorphism of the circle, and what I will be describing will be some kind of generalization of this quantum geometry. So, what is it? Just let me, just because probably not everything is here, absolutely, it is this quantum. Germany, so let me just remind some basic stuff. Well, so what is quantum method? So we have an odd-dimensional manifold, and on this odd-dimensional manifold, we have a completely non-integrable plane. So this is a kind of intrinsic definition of quantum structure, and while completely non-integrability can be defined as many way, but say probably most convenient way to say that we have a defined by quantum equation at least locally, then what you want the alpha is to succeed, not the general. So this is a symplectic form symplectic on C. Or which is the same thing as saying alpha, the alpha is so far forward. So, by the way, this alpha
C equals the kernel of alpha.
Like C is equal to the kernel of alpha. So, this is a like odd dimensional definition. Why, by the way, it has to be odd dimensional? Because otherwise, this complete this condition just follows. Because syntactic form is this continuous dimension, therefore, this only this odd dimension. But, so, also, very important point of quantum manifold is just kind of projectivization of symplectic. So, if you have a symplectic, so if you have a Euclidean space and you have an action of homotasis for Euclidean space, and this, if you take equations, it will project the space and you have a projective geometry. Precisely the same way, if you have a symplectic space or you have a symplectic manifold, and on this symplectic manifold, have an action of, say, R-class by, or I would rather write maybe, of R-class for the set of Hund numbers by symplectic dilation. So that means that if you take a state number lambda, and this lambda number lambda defines some action on our variable, which dilates exactly what lambda times. And so if you have this conformal convective action, then and you take a trajectory.
Certain things
better seen within this odd dimensional manifold, but certain things are better seen if you simplify and you think about contact geometry as a kind of equivalent symplectic geometry of this manifold together with this section. So, well, let me give you just a couple more examples of contact manifolds. More, meaning that we already have one example, this is this one. On this one, you just clearly see this non-integrable plane still, zero-dimensional. Well, but still you see this kind of form, alpha, the alpha, to then minus one, they are vanishing. So everything fine. And also, of course, if you think in this term, this precisely, if you just quotient function plane by radial action, you get just circle. So the circle is kind of full right of contact manifold. So, now, but besides, so this construction, of course, if you just apply to any Euclidean space, and then you get standard contact structure on 2n minus 1 dimensional sphere, and this contact structure can be visualized as a plane field orthogonal to Hopf vibration. So, another kind of standard example is the following. If you take a cotangent bundle of our manifold, so if you take a cotangent bundle of a manifold, then this, of course, well, this is a cotangent bundle, but this cotangent bundle, if you delete zero section, then it precisely admits this vector field P or the radial vector field of the fiber P or P or P. And this is this type of vector field, and therefore you can take a quotient. You get a projectivized cotangent bundle. You can kind of completely projectivize or just take a quality projectivization and get sphere bundle. And so in both cases, you get a projectivized cotangent bundle or kind of qualitative projectivized cotangent bundle, which is just the same as unit cotangent bundle. This is another canonical structure of contact. So another just important example arises when you take a symplectic manifold. Because there's a kind of also factor going from symplectic manifold to contact manifold is increasing dimension. If you have a symplectic manifold with integral cohomology class, then you can take an S1 bundle, which has this class as a Schirm class, and then this S1 bundle has a connection for square root J equal to omega. And then this that by definition, this connection precisely is the S1 invariant quantum structure. Well, for instance, if you apply this construction to R2n, then you get a quantum structure on R2n cross S1, and well, also you can take this quantum form can be chosen as a GTQ form here. So this is the kind of important for me example. So we want to talk about more. So as I said, this form alpha is not a part of contact structure, but still this is a kind of trend of all this modern mathematics. That you always tend to study something, you introduce a lot of additional structures, then you try to, with all methods you can, to get rid of this additional structure. And so you first look at this contact form and see what it brings. And then see what is invariant of the information which you can extract from this alpha. So getting alpha, you immediately can take a d alpha, and d alpha is already degenerate form on contact manifold, on odd dimensional manifold, and in particular it has a kernel. There is this one dimensional relation which tangent to kernel of the form d alpha, called kind of a free relation. And you can, in fact, define vector fields, which are not r alpha, which generate this kernel, and you can normalize it by the condition that alpha for this vector field is 1. Vector field transfers to the focus field. It's kind of orthogonal normal, orthogonal vector field to focus field. So this is called the red vector field for context 4, and this red vector field has a property that if you flow along this vector field, it's preserved not only psi but alpha itself. That just preserved, completely preserved everything that you can. So define this one parametric group of quantum transformation. For instance, in this example, when we're talking about unit potential bundle, the device potential bundle, you could get this form alpha by starting from Riemannian metric on our manifold. If we have a Riemannian metric on the manifold, then we get unit potential bundle, which gets induced form PT2, and then corresponding rev flow is just geodesic flow. And so, in particular, all this kind of dynamics of geodesic flow is a kind of partial case of question about dynamics of the rev. In this sense, all Riemannian geometry is part of quantum. So, well, let's return to symplectic world. So in symplectic world, kind of non-trivial symplectic history began with in the 80s with Gromov non-squeezing theory. So that's kind of essence of kind of symplectic rigidity is that if you say if you have a ball, if you take it to space R to N, and you take it to a dimensional ball of radius R, then not only you cannot squeeze it in ball of smaller radius, that would be kind of trivial because symplectic transformation also volume. But you cannot squeeze it if you can take for instance qualities, or you can take ellipsoid, which is has a one radius R, R1 and R2, and R2 is very big, so volume would allow this embedding. But still, if R1 is less than R, then you cannot technically squeeze this one together. So this kind of thing is just which led to all the development of symplectic invariant and symplectic topology and floor topology and symplectic topology. So just kind of started from this kind of fact. And I always wanted to kind of to have analysts of this in quantum. So you see, in contact geometry, contact structure is a kind of conformal. So you can take the whole space and squeeze it to arbitrary small neighborhood. There is nothing kind of like volume. And so, just what kind of non-squeezing result can hold in contact geometry? Well, there is something which I knew already long ago, that for instance, if you take a three-dimensional space, and in three-dimensional space, let's take the space pattern contact structure. Let me write it kind of one. I want to write it this way. And let's take solid torus, which is a neighborhood of one transversal to contact structure. So all transversals have the same kind of isomorphic neighborhood. So you can think that take the z axis, and so you just take a neighborhood. This is the model. You take a neighborhood for radius r, and you just take quotient this neighborhood under action z goes to z plus one. And then you get this solid torus. And then what you observe, then on the boundary of the solid torus, you can restrict out this form to the boundary, and you get some kind of spiral. And consider embeddings, or that we try to squeeze this solid torus inside itself. We are, so suppose, suppose we are better, this is not RC, but let's think about this, like portion by this, the action of everything sitting in R2 process form. And then, if you try to, via isotopy, take thick torus and squeeze it to thin torus, then you cannot do it. So this, somehow, this kind of thickness, this is something. Well, so, but this was in this case, actually, by anything. By contact isotopic. There is no contact isotopic to the standard one in this ambient space, which is squeezed figure 1 to 2. I will then explain this result later. So this is the only thing, basically, which I knew, and it had some kind of generalization in high dimension, which I called some invariants, which I called contact shapes, which were based on some fantastic property which was discovered by Sikora. And it was a following observation, that if you take a potential bundle of torus, and then if you take a potential bundle of torus, there is a canonical splitting into E cross E cross and if you take in this if you take a set of four CN cross A, then and you are now trying symplectically embed one of such sets into another, you try to find the effect CN cross A into CN cross B, and suppose you try to do it via map which is on homology-induced identity map. And then you can only do it if A already exists. There is no way you can speak it. That's just completely no possibility. And of course, this result immediately implies corresponding result. Some result contact non-squeezing, because this, if you take the potential bundle of CN minus zero section, this is the same as the sympathization of this projectivized potential bundle. And so, therefore, if you take a set A and conical set and apply to this, you get immediately corresponding result to contact. So, this is the only thing which I knew, but it's still kind of was very limited area of reading. So, suppose we have a manifold for a two process one. This is a unit potential bundle. The simplification of this is the potential bundle minus zero six. And if you take any set, any arc in S1, and when you simplify, you get this conical. So, therefore, the non-squeezing result for arcs is the same as non-squeezing result for the same in simplicity. Well, so, let me immediately formulate you some kind of theorem, which I'm just trying to explain today, and also, later I will explain the relationship of this with all properties, kind of dynamical properties of the contact transformation, for instance, like rotation number. So, let's decide to do this. Let's take this example. Let's take R2L and say multiply this R2L across S1. And then let's consider that form similar, like I already considered that I take EZ minus, well, I just used to write minus. So you just take this symplectic manifold and kind of contactize. And then any estimate of this R2. And then you have a kind of surprising result. Namely, so, what you can, so if you have embedding in this direction, of course, you want some kind of bound on R2, on the bigger of the stress. And so, you would expect that something like volume or whatever should be also. The only thing which I can prove is the following, that R2, this R2 should be satisfied the following inequality. So this R2 should satisfy the inequality. N times, we take a N R2 squared over R1 integer part times R integer part. And this should be equal to greater than equal than N R2 squared. And also, this should be equal. You should take N such as this greater than equal than 1. So, the statement is that for any N, this should be true. For any N such as this is greater than 1, this inequality should fall. So you see, the bigger n, so what is, when n goes to infinity, that is, what is here just R1. Because, you see, well, you divide by,
of this one.
but I'm allowed either to scale them down or up. And so what I'm saying is that what I'm defining is that this is a plus epsilon iteration of the both values of R and of the smallest dimension of it. And then if I scale it sufficiently for epsilon, there is, well, I cannot say about precise estimate, but for epsilon small enough, you can find big size ellipsoid, which you cannot. But there is no abstraction that small, if you scale it really small, then you can. And I ask, isn't it possible or not? So I will kind of explain a little bit later what is my discussion.
How is scaling part of the
you see, scaling is a circle. And so when you scale it, it's not contact transformation, so it's changing. It's a symplectic world, it's conformally symplectic, we preserve everything. But in this one, you just, it's very bad transformation in respect to contact transformation. Guys, I keep saying, S1 is 1. Ectomorphism from this domain. namely, on the boundary of the domain, on any hypersurface in symplectic manifold, you have a characteristic relation that corresponding to Hamiltonian vector. And then you can kind of go along this top part of graph, and then return over the flat section that takes this holonomy. And this holonomy map is precisely symplectomorphism generated by this. And so therefore, if you just start to deform this domain via symplectic isotopy, then your diffeomorphism remain unchanged up to conjugation. And it's invariant, diffeomorphism is invariant of the domain. Therefore, all invariants of this domain symplectic are invariant of symplectomorphism. In particular, the Hopper normal symplectomorphism is just Gromov prints of this domain. So therefore, there is always this way to go from symplectomorphism to domain.
In a sense, it's all invariant, so therefore,
all invariants of this symplectic domain are invariant of this diffeomorphism of the conjugation class of the diffeomorphism. You have Hamiltonian function, and it generates some flow. And suppose I fix isotopy, and I fix F1, so it starts with from identity and ends with F1. And I fix F1. Now I can change, for instance, Hamiltonian isotopy, but I require that always produce the same form. And what I'm saying is that this is just, this diffeomorphism can be viewed, seen from this domain, because it just can polynomial of all the bound. So therefore, if I know the invariant of the symplectic domain, I know the... So this Hopper norm of the symplectomorphism is precisely Gromov width of this domain. So the same construction. So the same holds in contact. If you have between contact domain and contact symplectomorphism, there is the same kind of relation. So in particular, this is a, let me kind of carry this discussion. Well, let me give you this example for a circle. So let me give you contact definition of what is the rotation number of the diffeomorphism of the circle. Well, so you have the circle, and you have, say, some isotopy of the circle. And then for this this construction, this discussion, this kind of graph construction, which I was telling in the case of this circle, would just give me precisely the following thing. I would take the space, this is my circle, take the circle, F1, in the plane R2, take this axis, call it Z, this axis. And now I consider this kind of construction, this graph, give me some path. Some tube in this R2 cross this interval 0,1. And on the boundary, I have I have here a standard contact structure, say dz minus yx coordinates. And on the boundary of this domain, I have this characteristic relation, just intersection of contact plane with this. So now let's assume that the flow flow which generates the intermorphism is superior. What? You take a... Okay, I didn't tell you what the domain, I'll say. So, you take, so I am saying, given isotopies, I can construct a domain in this R2 process 1. And so, such as I quotient this domain, and then this polynomial, which is generated by this flow, will be precisely the diffeomorphism which I am. So now I would like to understand what is rotation number for this one. And I'm saying the following. Let's take it now round cylinder, certain way. And you try by contact embedding. No, this is not cylinder, it's kind of, it's a torus. I identified the part. And you try by contact, by this contact isotopic to identity map, squeeze this one inside this domain. And the biggest one which you can squeeze, radius of this one is precisely rotation. And so, rotation number of diffeomorphism has this pure contact definition. And now you see that this kind of contact definition can be carried out to just high dimensions. So. Well, it's invariant under contact smooth, everything smooth, I'm talking about that, not topological, I don't know. But in smooth category, it's invariant under all contact diffeomorphism of the surface. So now you can produce kind of absolutely similar thing in the case of contactomorphism of the of say S3. We take S3. And then for contactomorphism of S3, there is also analog of this rotation number defined precisely via the for contact diffeomorphism. You with contact diffeomorphism you associate this tube. And then you try to at the same time squeeze in this tube the kind of the maximal possible round this solid torus. And this is rotation number. And you can kind of squeeze in smallest one and squeeze outside. And then you can get lower rotation now and upper rotation. It's not clear that they concern. You have just two inverts. Actually, they do not concern. They definitely do not concern like this might from ceiling. There's some gap in there. But then, let me kind of tell you a little bit another way how you can see. So a little bit more dynamical way to interpret. This is written in our paper. So suppose you have any contact diffeomorphism. Suppose you have say two contacts or some contact method. So I will say F is bigger than G if FG minus 1 can be generated by positive contact momentum. So, as I said, all contact transformations are, in fact, symplectic, can be used as symplectic. And so, therefore, you can always associate this contact transformation with some homogeneous symplectic Hamiltonian. And so, if you want this homogeneous Hamiltonian to be positive, and then if you can generate by different by positive Hamiltonian, then I say that one is bigger than the other. And then what you do is the following. For this.
I don't understand what you mean. You always had a contact.
No, it's contact. You see, there is a following normalization. Because in everything, contact leads to kind of equivalent homogeneous symplectic. And so in particles can be generated by first degree homogeneous in this T coordinate Newton. So if you insist on this, then it's constant. And so, so you have this definition. Then what is rotation? it's transitive, but it's completely not obvious that it's not trivial. So now, suppose you take a sphere. Well, actually, any manifold, but let's take a sphere with standard contact form. A standard contact form of sphere generates this rotation of the sphere along rep vibration. So let's call this Vx. And what now? What is rotation now in my definition? Equivalent definition is the following. So you take diffeomorphism F. And so let's go take law rotation number of this diffeomorphism F. The biggest S such that this Vs, this form Vs, biggest S such that Vs is smaller than some diffeomorphism conjugated to F. Not necessarily F exactly, but it can be less than something conjugated to F by isotopic to identity contact of
other.
Vs is just rotation of the sphere. Vs is just rotation of the sphere along the sphere. S belongs to the surface. Yeah, I'm sorry. So in fact, yeah, I am absolutely kind of sloppy. So it's an ordering not of the group of contact that vary but on universal count. And so this is definition, and then you can take also minimum. And then just here reverse. So this is the upper rotation. So it's just bigger than this. And then you can kind of pass to the limit. You can say stabilize it, take iterate L and compare with SM. And then you get some kind of asymptotic rotation. And for this asymptotic rotation number, already it's easy to prove that they can set. No, still I cannot prove. So for asymptotic rotation number, you get some asymptotic rotation number which is smaller than this one. So now, this theory, which I gave you about the small physics. So in particular, you can take this example. If you take this ellipsoid cross S1 is also can be viewed as a graph of certain contact isotopes. And you can compare this and the just round ball cross S1 can be viewed as a graph of this standard rotation. And so any kind of no squeezing result here is a given a squeezing result. And So what you get that between these numbers in this case, indeed there is a gap. And this gap is precisely the difference between this number and the number. But if you go to the limit, this is kind of equivalent as sending n to infinity, called r2 squared to 0. And therefore, in the limit, no methods allow to kind of to distinguish these two things. But I don't know if indeed they're the same. The conjectures, as I say, have to be the same. But I don't know. Okay, so my time already expired, so. But I need still to give you proof. Thank you.
Which actually is not something out of blue.
true because it's the standard thing how it's done in statistical geometry. You do the following. You want to define invariant of certain dimension. So you first pick any context form. Then you consider all kind of functions, f, which have, which say constant, which such as f equals 1 on the, this domain, and big outside. And then you start to compute homology of this form f alpha with some fixed c. You fix c and compute this homology of alpha, and there is this, when you increase the form, there is this sort of homomorphism in this homology from bigger form to smaller. Like always, for functions, there is a kind of homology. And so you get kind of inverse limit of this when this f goes to infinity in this class. And after that, you take a limit when c goes to infinity. But in this order, it's very important. And then this result already, again, contact invariant. It's independent of alpha, but it's independent on remembered q. And what is, in fact, what is the requirement domain? That invariant of this contact domain. So what, how you see this invariant? So this invariant is just precisely this ref orbit, it's just the following thing. You just take, the, you have a domain in symplectic manner. On the boundary of this domain, you have a Hamiltonian system. Now, you take, you multiply this boundary of this domain times this one. So this is times, that's what many of the which I want to apply. It's a, the boundary of the domain, like sphere or ellipsoid, and you multiply it by this one. Now, on the, now this ref trajectory, when you start to consider form which goes that steep, that all essential trajectory turns out to be precisely on this steep path. So kind of cutting off everything outside, nothing interesting inside, and everything just concentrated on this path. And you precisely understand the dynamic of this path. The dynamics of this boundary is the following, that for every closed trajectory downstairs, you have this torus over this trajectory, and my flow is in the, keep this torus invariant, and slope equal to the action of this trajectory. And so, the, no, slope is not equal to action. There is a kind of family of the slope as I can turn this down. And so, there exists the slope changing from vertical to smallest possible value, which is equal to action of this trajectory. And so, what happens when you take a, say, when you increase, then you get kind of, it's more kind of, the region where the slope can value is small. And now you can define this, our homology is based on this, on kind of, on all this work. And now you see where all these integers come. Because I have a, I do not feel this slope, but I can take a, all possible slopes with rational coefficients, with kind of rational slope, you give me periodic order. And only those are kind of, which I can detect. And for this slope, I need to compare their index in a kind of, in a, how many times they go downstairs detected by Maslach index there. And you have an action in this direction. And this kind of pressure is precisely giving this index. But kind of dynamics of all these numbers is very complicated because, well, not really complicated, but really kind of delicate because it just depends on iteration of this irrational number.
Any other question?
Oh, great. So my duty as a last speaker to say that I've got